Emanuela?
Sì, ciao.
Ah, Emanuela, actually, we can able to see your slides. It is
It's
visible
possible
to me.
to see. You see my files?
Yeah, it is visible
Ah,
to us.
okay.
I'm sorry, it's getting a little bit.
No, it's okay.
Hello. Hello.
Hello?
Hello. Can you hear me, Dr. Emmanuel Crisia?
Sì. Yes. I can hear you.
Good
Can you hear me?
Good afternoon. I am Dr. Nagappan, head of the institution of this engineering college in Salem, Tamil Nadu.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you. Nice to
Thank
meet
you too much to invite me for this webinar. Thank
you.
you
Yeah,
too much.
Thank you for accepting to deliver your speech in this webinar. Thank you. You have been residing in Italy, isn't it?
Sorry, I don't understand too much.
You have been put up in Rome?
In Italy? In Italy?
Right.
In Italy, we are closing all the things again in a few days.
Can we start the program? Everybody is there. Good afternoon to all viewers from various places in the nation. I am very happy to inaugurate this international webinar on ion exchange membranes for fuel cells applications to be delivered by Dr. Emmanuel Grisia, Department of Industrial Engineering, University of Rome, from Italy. Thank you, ma'am, for accepting our invitation.
Thank you. This
particular webinar will be much useful to all of you, and I hope that at the end of the session, you will be knowing about the importance of ion exchange, particularly for fuel cells application. I have to thank my colleagues, Dr. Sasi Kumar, Dr. Tamil Vanan, Professor Gilbert, and Dr. Arun Kumar, for arranging such good international webinars under Institute Innovation Council. I have to inform you happily that this institution has been ranked one among top 25 institutions in India under ARIA ranking, that is Atal Innovation Ranking for Institutions in Innovation Achievements. And this institution has also been awarded 5-star rating, one among 125 institutions in India for its innovation activities in Institute Innovation Council of India. I'm happy to share these two awards, which we got in this pandemic period in 2020. And I am just sharing this happy news to all of you. I hope you will be enjoying the webinar very well. I have to thank once again Dr. Emanuela Vicia for accepting our request. Thank you, madam, and thank you one and all for you. And I am handing over the proceedings to Dr. Emanuela for delivering her lecture. Thank you. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable address. And before going into this session, we would like to give you a short bio about the resource person, Dr. Emanuela Grecia. Dr. Emanuela Grecia received her Laureate Diploma in 2003 in Electronic Engineering at the University of Rome, Tor Vergata. In 2010, she obtained her joint PhD in Chemistry at the University of Rome, Tor Vergata, Italy, and University of Aix-Marseille, France. Actually, her PhD was granted, it was financed by the Franco-Italian University. Between 2003 and 2006, she worked in the area of chemical sensors development at the Chemical Sensors Group of Rome, Tor Vergata University. Dr. Emanuela Grecia was involved in the study, characterization, and optimization of chemical sensors based on mass transduction having metalloporphyrin as chemically interactive material. She focused her attention on the effect of the thickness of chemically reactive materials on the sensor response and studied the influence of different deposition techniques of chemically interactive materials on sensor performances. In particular, she tested and improved the sublimation of metalloporphyrins for chemical sensor applications. From 2006 to 2012, Dr. Emanuela Grecia worked in the area of polymer membranes for PEM fuel cells at the Department of Chemical Sciences and Technology. Her research work developed during the European project LOLIPEM was concerned with the development of proton conducting membranes based on sulfonated aromatic polymers like SPIC, SPPSU, and ESPES. She explored several strategies for the synthesis of ionomers, such as the preparation of organic inorganic hybrid materials and the formation of cross-linked polymers by solvothermal procedures. From 2017 to 2020, she was an adjunct professor of stoichiometry and electrochemistry complements at the engineering faculty. Dr. Emanuela Grecia is currently working at the Department of Industrial Engineering of Rome, Tor Vergata University, under the European project CREATE. Her current research is focused on the synthesis and characterization of new anionic and amphoteric membranes based on aromatic polymers for energy applications. She is investigating innovative procedures for the development of new membranes with increased performances. At present, Dr. Emanuela Grecia is a member of the International Associated Laboratory, Ionomer Materials for Energy, and she co-tutor of a PhD student. At present, she has authored more than 25 papers on international journal, one book chapter, one patent, and she has also communicated more than 20 communications in international congresses. And finally, now I request Dr. Emanuela Grecia to deliver her presentation. Emanuela, now the stage is yours.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Okay. Good afternoon to everyone. First of all, I want to thank the organizer to invite me at this webinar and all the people is connected now via the web. Today I'm talking about the ion exchange membrane for fuel cell application that we synthesized in our lab during last years. As your professor said, I'm coming from the Tor Vergata University at precisely from the Faculty of Engineer, Industrial Engineer. This is, I am a member of a lab called the International Laboratory of Ionomers Materials for Energy. And our research topic is, in this laboratory, we study the synthesis of ionomers and obtain better membrane than those currently used. We study a new synthesis of amphoteric ionomers, which are materials that change the property by changing the pH. In our lab, especially at Marseille University, we study on lithium battery, solid electrolyte for redox for battery, and new inorganic solid electrolyte. This is the outline of this webinar, of my webinar. I'm talking about the two main classes of membranes based on sulfonated aromatic polymers, the composite and the membranes obtained with cross-linked polymers. In the end, I'll talk about an ion exchange membrane we synthesize in the laboratory based on another aromatic polymer, the polyphenylene oxide.
Sorry, Emanuela.
Sorry. Tell me.
Oh, okay.
Tell me.
You cannot see. Your
you
slide is
see?
Not changing. That's yeah. Your slide is not changing. That's why.
It's better in this manner. Can you see my presentation? Sorry,
yeah. It is visible. Yeah, it is visible now.
Now it's visible.
Yes.
Okay, sorry. If I change the slide, can you see the changing of slides?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we can see.
Okay, here in these slides, you can see the main classes of fuel cell. The use of one type instead of another depends on the application for which it is intended. For example, the alkaline and proton exchange fuel cell are employed in cars and in general in portable power system. A polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cell is made up of a membrane electrode assembly where we find an anode where hydrogen is oxidized to a proton, a cathode where oxygen is reduced, and then it recombines with the protons to form water, which is the exhaust, and the proton exchange membrane. The proton exchange membrane is the electrolyte, and its role is to separate the anode and the cathode at the same time to allow the proton migration from anode to cathode and to prevent the crossover phenomena. Another a particular polymer electrolyte membrane is the fuel cell that use methanol as fuel. The problem of this fuel cell is that it has carbon dioxide as exhaust, but its advantages is the portability of reducing the size, the possibility, sorry, of reducing the size of fuel cell, and to have the possibility to replace batteries in mobile phone, digital cameras, and laptops. The obstacle to overcome is the low efficiency due to the permeation of methanol to the electrolyte. Another system much studied are the alkaline fuel cell. Why? Because the polymer electrolyte fuel cell that use proton as movable ions need the noble metals like platinum on the electrodes to allow the reactions. The use of this metal increases the manufacturing cost. The alkaline fuel cell overcome this problem because reactions do not need noble metals as a catalyzer. A lot of efforts must be done to increase the stability of the electrolyte because it works at high value of pH and degrades rapidly at the conductivity of the system. Okay, sorry, now I can't show you the animation, but first of all, the membrane, how is made of it? The ion exchange membrane are typically composed of hydrophobic substrate, immobilized ion functionalized group, and movable counterions. An ion exchange membrane can be prepared using as hydrophobic substrate, inorganic materials like phosphate salt, zeolite, or organic materials such as polymer, or inorganic material obtained, for example, by sol gel technique. The immobilized functional group characterize the type of ion exchange membrane. Cation exchange membrane contain negatively charged group and allow the passage of cations and reject anions. In this case, we have, for example, the hydrogen fuel cell. Vice versa, anion exchange membrane are characterized by positively charged group and allow the passage of anions and reject cations. And in this class, for example, we have the anion exchange membrane that use OH- ions as carrier. The main requirements asked for a polymer electrolyte membranes are mechanical strength, high conductivity, controlled water absorption, chemical and thermal stability, low permeability to reactants, and low life. However, to optimize the thermal and cooling management in a fuel cell, the proton exchange membrane could operate at temperature above 120 Celsius degree and use anhydrous inlet gas. Here, the proton exchange membrane, when they are dry, are insulating material. The ion conductivity is allowed only when this membrane are hydrated. For this reason, the ability to absorb water and the behavior in wet condition are studied. The parameters that help us to study this are the water uptake, which is the percentage increment of the sample weight, and lambda, which is defined as the number of water molecules that can be absorbed every functional group. Here in this slide, you can see how the degree of hydration of a membrane, here is represented Nafion 117, influences the ionic conductivity. By the degree of hydration depends on the way of diffusion of ion through the membrane. When the hydration is low, the vehicular mode of diffusion is observed. In this case, the ions move together water molecules. When the hydration instead becomes high enough, the ions move from water molecule to the next via hydrogen bonding. Here, as you can see, is resumed the mechanism of the two conductivity mechanism. In Grotthus mechanism, the advantages of a Grotthus mechanism is that you you have a continuous movement of the ion without that without the moving of water molecule. Okay. Water retention, mechanical strength and proton conductivity depend on the delicate balance between hydrophobicity and hydrophilicity. In a membrane it's possible distinguish three regions. The region in yellow, you can see yellow, the hydrophobic region. The white, sorry, the green, the green part containing pendant side chains, some ionic group and counter ions, and some water. And finally, the green region contains the majority of pendant functional group, counter ions, and absorbed water. When a new polymer electron membrane is synthesized, a new balance of these three regions must be obtained. The proton exchange membrane must used now is Nafion. Is characterized by excellent chemical, mechanical, thermal stability and has a high ionic conductivity when it is hydrated. But it is very expensive and these performances are conditioned by the content of water. This feature were a stimulus of scientists to find an alternative to Nafion. In our laboratories, we are studying membranes based on aromatic polymer, such as polyether ether ketone and polyphenyl sulfone. These fully aromatic polymers are much investigated because they satisfy a lot of requirements. In fact, they are cheap and their aromatic structure allows the thermal stability, oxidation resistance, and easy functionalization. Their use in fuel cell requires an adequate conductivity, which can be obtained by sulfonation. When sulfonated, they present a considerable proton conductivity, but a high degree of sulfonation, the membranes show a large swelling and a high relative humidity, they become soluble. To improve the behavior of membrane, a lot of techniques that include interaction between two or more polymers can be used. Here it's possible to see the different interaction that can be obtained between the different polymers, ordered by the strength of the bonds. On the top of this scale, we find the weaker interaction, Van der Waals forces, while the bottom, we find the stronger interaction, the covalent bond between the two polymers. The first system I'm showing you are composites. The composites are studied at the majority partner that maintains the high conductivity in the membrane, while the minority partner maintains the thermal and mechanical stability. These two partners are held together by Van der Waals interaction. The composite studied were made of the 93% of sulfonated peak as the majority partner and the second partner, the 7% in weight of sulfonated, silylated or sulfonated, silylated polyphenyl sulfone. The second composite that I briefly present you was made of sulfonated peak, the 95%, and functionalized dioxide titanium. Let's see the first sample, the first class. Sulfonated poly, vinyl sulfone, and polyether ether cotton were obtained by reacting polyether ether ketone in concentrated sulfuric acid, and then keeping the mixture stirring at different temperatures for different times. In this way, we have obtained sulfonated peak having a different degree of sulfonation, as shown in this table. In the same manner, sulfonated polyphenyl sulfone was obtained following dissolving it in sulfuric acid and keeping the solution under stirring at 50 degrees C for 3 days. The degree of sulfonation of both samples was evaluated by NMR spectroscopy and by titration. Sulfonated polyphenyl sulfone was obtained with a degree of sulfonation of 200%. The desilylated polyphenyl sulfone instead has been obtained by metallation reaction with butyl lithium at low temperature in tetrahydrofurane, followed by electrophilic substitution by phenyltrichlorosilane. Post-sulfonation was achieved in concentrated sulfuric acid. In this case, we find two rings activated, so the maximum value of the degree of sulfonation that can be reached is 2. The product was analyzed by several techniques, and elemental analysis showed a degree of sulfonation of 2 and a degree of silylation of 0.05. In this picture, you can see, I report the typical stress stain curve obtained for the T-type of composite. From this curve, it's possible to obtain several parameters, such as Young modulus, which is evaluated by the slope of the first linear part of the curve, the maximum strength, and that can be exercised, and the relative membrane deformation. The first observation we can see in this picture is that silicon increases the strength of membrane. Here are reported the value obtained from stress strain experiment. As you can see, sulfonated peak is a very soft material compared to peak. The introduction of sulfonic group in the second phase make the membrane too soft, as you see in pink table, pink value, while the adding of silicon increases the strength of membrane considerably. The water uptake was evaluated too, and was evaluated by immersing the sample in deionized water at room temperature. Here you can see the value of lambda in function of the time of immersion. The data shows that while the water uptake of blend without silicon is very high, is too much, the blend containing only silicon and no sulfur is stable with a lambda more or less equal to 8. The better result seems they were obtained for the composite made of sulfonated peak and silylated polyphenyl sulfone. For this sample was evaluated the proton conductivity and at 100 degrees C. And we can see that under the 80% of relative humidity, the conductivity of the two membranes can be superposed. Over the 80%, the membrane of Pugh's Peak become unstable and the conductivity decreases. Instead, the conductivity of composite is still stable. Conclude, we can say that the system which has the higher strength less lower water uptake coefficient, but at the same time increases the membrane performances. We investigated all another. This composite was made of sulfonated PEEK as majority partner and functionalized dioxide titanium as second partner. How was functionalized this dioxide titanium? By polymethyl hydroxysilane and give to this compound an hydrophobic behavior, or by three hydroxymethyl propane, which give an hydrophilic behavior of this compound. The composite where the membrane were obtained the same manner of the previous the previous composite, and the first things we saw was that the hydrophilic compound, the introduction of hydrophilic dioxide titanium, led to a non-uniform membrane. We saw on the membrane the aggregates, and this it can be a problem for the membranes because locally you can have a different behavior. So you can have some parts of the membrane that are less stable than other parts, or have a different strength compared to the other part of membrane. We concentrated our attention on dioxide titanium functionalized by hydrophobic, having a hydrophobic behavior. In this case, it was possible to evaluate the water uptake and the ionic conductivity. And we saw that the conductivity was stable until 90% of relative humidity, and is introduction in the membrane reduced the swelling of membrane. The second type of membrane we studied was studying obtaining taking in account that applying annealing the polymer increases the glass transition temperature and the mechanical strength. So we want to investigate how the heat treatment of ionomer can change the characteristics of this membrane. First of all, we obtain membranes, synthesized membrane using casting technique, using different solvents, dimethyl sulfoxide or dimethyl acetamide. After that, after the removing solvent, we thermally treat this membrane at different temperature and for different time. After that, we measure the water uptake, the ability to absorb water of this membrane at different water temperature. As you can see, the membrane synthesized with dimethyl acetamide leads to a very high water uptake. Instead, the membrane thermally treated, synthesized by dimethyl sulfoxide and thermally treated, reduce the lambda value, especially since that the best result was obtained, the right compromise was obtained with the sample treated at 160 degrees C for 64 hours. Just to have an idea of the behavior of membrane, here in this picture, you can see the on S, the sample of pure speak, a dry pure speak. Here on P instead, is you can see how is the become the sample after 4 hours of immersion in water at room temperature. Instead, here on E, there is the sample thermally treated and 160 degrees C for 64 hours. Here, the how is the sample after the immersion at 25 degrees in water at 25 degrees C for 4 hours. And here, instead, after 4 hours, the immersion in water at 145 degrees C. It's very, very important to have a low swelling of this membrane. So the mechanical measurement are shown here for different thermal treatment. Here in white is report white line is reported the untreated peak typical curve of untreated peak membrane. Instead, as you can see, by the other materials, the other thermal treatment leads to a higher value of Young modulus, especially for the sample treated at 160 degrees C for 64 hours. But we investigated the reason of this behavior. The thermal thermogravimeter show that all samples thermally treated have different decreasing of the weight at the temperature of silicon group degradation, is this one. Degradation give as a result that this membrane has a lower degree of sulfonation compared to the starting material, but at the same time the elemental analysis say that the number of sulfur present in this polymer, in this membrane, was unchanged. So we think that we obtain a cross-link reaction by simply applying the thermal treatment. This data confirmed by infrared analysis. In fact, as you can see here, this peak is related to this bond between these two rings. There is reported the proposal mechanism of cross-link reaction. So what we can what else we done in order to optimize the time of thermal treatment at the temperature, we fixed a temperature and change the time, the hours we thermally treated this membrane. And we found that while the Young modulus tends to increase with the time of thermal treatment, the water uptake decreases, but reach a plateau. So for this, using this data, we saw that for this membrane, for peak membrane, the best thermal treatment we can obtain was applying the thermal treatment at 180 degrees C for 8 hours. In this manner, we increasing the temperature and reducing the time of thermal treatment, it's possible to obtain a good behavior of membrane without to have a long time of thermal thermal treatment. This membrane, the, when we optimize the thermal treatment, we test this membrane, the ionic conductivity. In this case, you can see that the thermally treated membrane is has a value more or less can be superposed the ionic conductivity value, the ionic conductivity values with the one obtained of for untreated sample, and it remains stable. But the important thing is that this membrane doesn't swell, because you can imagine that membrane electrode assembly is made of a membrane that is keep is kept between two electrodes. When the membrane swells too much, it's possible to lose the contact between the two electrodes, and it's possible to have the a short circuit. Avoiding the swelling phenomena, it's possible to maintain in good condition the behavior of the fuel cell. So, at the end of our study, we saw that the cross-link phenomena was possible to obtain only by dimethyl sulfoxide, using as solvent dimethyl sulfoxide, and temperature above 120 degrees C. So for this reason, dimethyl sulfoxide can participate to by cross-link during cross-link reaction. So at the beginning of my presentation, we are changing the argument. I told you that the proton exchange membrane systems are too expensive. For this reason, a lot of researchers are studying an exchange. In our laboratories, we synthesize an ion exchange based on today, I'm presenting you a membrane based on polyphenylene oxide and functionalized by trimethylamine. So the membrane were obtained by the PPO, polyphenylene oxide, using the functionalized polymer was obtained following two different routes. In the first case the polyphenylene oxide was first of all chloromethylated and biaminated and later aminated, and in second route instead the polyphenylene oxide was brominated and then aminated. You think that why this study? Because the route followed for the for functionalization of this polymer changed the membrane behavior. Here you can see the water water uptake measurement obtained for the different sample. We can see that even if the membrane has exactly the same ion exchange capacity, the two routes leads to a different value of water uptake. It means that the root, the synthesis followed by the amination, for the amination, can change the behavior of the membrane. Allora, in this case, we can see that chloromethylated, the sample obtained from have a higher ability to absorb water. The stress strain test, instead, what can show? Show that brominated, the membrane obtained by bromination is a lower ductility than the one obtained by chloromethylation. But when they are the tests are repeated after the aging of this membrane, the sample obtained by bromination has a high stiffness. How to say, is less ductile and than the one obtained by chloromethylation. Okay, why is important to see the behavior of membrane after the aging? First of all, aging means that the membrane was kept in a concentrated alkaline solution at high temperature for, in this case, 72 hours, because the high value of pH can degrade the membrane. So close to the water uptake and the mechanical test, is important to see how the membrane react, the behavior of the membrane after to keep it for a long time in the in extreme condition. Okay, just to have an idea, which is the behavior during the fuel cell working. For this reason, the ionic conductivity was performed with on untreated membrane and after the aging. And we can see that after one day of degradation, the degradation of membrane is more or less similar. But after, this is without aging, and this is the first day. After 2 or 3 days of aging, you can see that the sample obtained by bromination has a better long time stability. What we can say? We can say that seems that the ability of absorbed water is better for membrane obtained by chloromethylation. But if we can see the behavior after the aging, seems that brominated PPO have a longer stability. So what we can say? We can say that the great demand for energy and the need of safeguard the environmental push researchers to develop systems with low environmental and fuel cell can be a part of the solution, but many efforts must be done to increase their performance. So I hope that you found this presentation interesting. I want to thank you for the webinar and for to follow me. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Emanuela Gracia, for an excellent presentation.
Thank you.
Yeah, Dr. Emanula, on behalf of everyone here today, we thank you for taking the time to speak to us today on the very important, interesting research topic. And we are sure your presentation would provide more information for the research and student community. Thank you once again, Dr. Emanula. Now the session is open to the audience for asking some questions to the guest speaker. So before that, please raise your hands, then only you can unmute your mic, then you can ask your questions directly. So before we go to the audience, Dr. Emanula, I have a question. Is it possible to make sulfonated polyether sulfone membrane?
Sorry, is it possible to obtain? I don't know. Because then I can hear it.
Yeah, pardon? Can you hear me?
Yes, not in good condition, but I try to answer. Can you repeat, please, the question? Because I don't...
Is it possible to make sulfonated polyether sulfone membrane?
So, and I stop. I can't hear. Stop the sulfone, sorry.
Yeah, one second, I repeat the question.
Sorry.
Is it possible to make us? I am audible now.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, now it's very good.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Sorry, but I...
Yeah, I typed the in chat box. Is it possible to make sulfonated polyether sulfone membrane?
Manuela, this is Tamil Vanan. Do you hear me? Manuel, do you hear me?
I don't know if I can hear the answer. If it's possible, maybe to write, I don't know. But I can't hear the question. Sorry.
Manuela, do you hear me? This is Tamil Warner. Sorry.
Okay. So this is the voice isn't breaking. I think the signal is not good here. Okay. So so due to the is not audible, so that's why we can conclude the session. It's a wonderful session. I think everyone, the participants, can get the knowledge from this good lecture given by Dr. Emanuela Rezia. And now this mic is handed to Professor Gilbert Raj from Department of Chemistry. He delivered a word of thanks.
I would like to thank our chief guest, Dr. Emanuela Rezia from the International Associated Laboratory, Italy, for her wonderful presentation on polymer electrolyte membrane.
Thank you too much. Thank you so much. Sorry, but the connection is very, very bad. I thank you too much to and to everyone to invite me on this
I would like to thank our chief guest, yes, Dr. Emanuela Rezia from the International Associated Laboratory, Italy, for her wonderful presentation on polymer electrolyte membrane fuel cells and enlightening us with her knowledge. Today's webinar was full of knowledge and interesting, some interesting facts. One thing I want to share here is that when we requested Dr. Emanuela for lecture program, she accepted our invitation without any hesitation, and we thank her for spending such a valuable time with us. I would like also thank our beloved principal, Dr. A. Nagappan, PMKVC, for his valuable guidance and moral support. I am happy to express a vote of thanks to our HODs, faculty members, students,
and participants from various institutions that have made this webinar a grand success through their motivation and dedication. And a great thanks to everyone. And with this, we shall conclude our session. Thank you.
Thank you so much to everyone.